folks, we're back here in one more episode of Straightforward. I'm here today with Ricardo Alem, who runs a digital innovation for Amazon in Latin America. And we're super excited for this conversation, as Ricardo has a role to kind of bring to Amazon clients a little bit of the culture of innovation from Amazon. And we're super excited to learn from that experience that he has to share with us here, and was super generous to and kind to accept the invitation. So with no further ado, thank you, Ricardo. If you can just explain a little bit about what's your role is and what's your experience so far in this role at Amazon, we'll be super excited to hear and learn from you.
Thank you so much. Thank you for your invitation. I am Ricardo Alem, and head of digital innovation for Latin America at AWS. I've been 3.5 years here at Amazon. I started with the architecture, and I have more than 20 years in the tech industry. My role today is to help the customers to experiment with the culture of innovation from Amazon and how it fits in their opportunities, in their culture. So we are here to support our customers in their innovation journey, in their transformation journey, more along with our culture and helping to experiment and to get their ideas and their products to life.
That is exciting and very challenging in the same way, I would guess, right? Because Amazon has such a different way to operate, right? And mainly around innovation and how innovation is attached to customer centricity, right? Like all the backwards model and framework of work. So how has been your experience trying to kind of bring that culture and practices to clients that are more traditional mainly? That's our audience here, is more traditional companies trying to become more digital ready and more digital native. I'm really curious to see, you know, what are the main challenges when you get that tool set from Amazon, that mindset, that those processes, and try to apply to more traditional companies. What are the main challenges there that you have to overcome?
I say that it's very fun, this job. Like, it's very challenging, but it's also very fun because we had this opportunity to talk to different type of customers. And it's not only a thing for traditional companies, but it's when you have a process that you say that you are a company that is looking to learn more, but your internal process and your internal mindset is not aligned with this. So one thing that Amazon learned along the way is to becoming a company that learns, and how we experiment, and that brought for us innovation. So we don't talk about innovation in our day by day. And that's one thing that we look at for in our relationship with these customers and the partners, because we don't want to talk about innovation and how to disrupt the world and how to create the next new biggest thing. We look at for how to delight the customers and recognize that the customers are always beautifully unsatisfied. So, and this opens for us a whole new set of opportunities, recognizing that the customers is always looking for more, always looking for do something differently. When we talk of these traditional companies and to companies that is looking to invent or reinventing themselves, we look at for additional points where we can position the ideas coming from the people that know their customers really well and how they can explore ideas. And that's very challenging because it requires you to have an entrepreneur mindset that creates like a small teams, like intra startups. But these internal startups requires sponsorships. And the sponsors usually come in from the board, come in from the top level executives. And that's where the things start to becoming more fun, because the people say that they are looking for that, but they are not willing to sponsorship these ideas or to getting these to the execution, especially when we cross border with other teams, other groups. So that's where we look at for how to break up these silos, break up these groups, and created a true multifunctional teams, multidisciplinary groups that it can leverage the ideas that they internally already have. And most of the customers that I talk, they know what is their next steps of innovations, but they don't know how to execute this. And one thing that Amazon was very good at along the time to execute is to keep the customer in the center. So this coming from the mission, this coming from the leadership principles. And as you mentioned, this was like true in our process or in our mechanisms to innovate it, that is the working backwards.
And I'm super curious to see like a lot of our clients try to kind of create those startup teams, like a separate and isolate the teams from the core, mm-hmm. right? The complexity of the core and try to, in what their experience, they usually report, hey, we did this, we separate a team to build this whatever experience, and they could build it in a speed that we never seen before, right? So that we're really excited, but we only were able to do this when we actually totally isolated them, and they couldn't leverage, you know, any of the assets of the core, right? So they couldn't use like the data that we have around customers, because if you expose them to the core, you expose them to the complexity, and they you bring their speed down again, right? So when you kind of create this startup-like and small teams of intrapreneurs of companies, how you actually make them, you know, connect to the core in a way that actually what they're building is actually not something, you know, a shiny object that's separated from the other assets of the company, but also, you know, helping the company see that there's another way to work and another way to go about, you know, customer needs and how to respond to them. Like, how do you connect those fast-moving small teams to the core in a meaningful way? Do you use like the support of the sponsor? Like, if you can share here with our audience, like a little some tricks on how to do this and how to do this in a way that it's meaningful and impactful.
Yeah, it was not always like this in Amazon. So we passed it through a transition that where we create an environment that we can have these type of teams, small teams, very decentralized. So what we have it today is what we, as we called, two pizza teams. So these small teams, it's like as two pizzas is enough to feed these teams in a happy hour or in a Friday lunch. So it means that the teams is like a size about 6 to 10 people. That is enough. And they must be enough to sustain any item, any subject. And we call them as a stupid team every time that we needed for something that is, I would say, isolated, but they are not isolated in the core. Right now, our core is spread across multiple two pizza teams. So it's like there is no core. Like we have a multiple teams. And these teams are oriented by subjects, oriented by themes. And these items, these objectives, though these leaders that they manage these threads, they looking for everything that is required for this thread. So with these organizations, these multiple teams oriented for one subject, one thread, they can organize in themselves. At the beginning of this, we are not so fast and not so oriented to these to items that impacted the customers. So when we have these opportunities, when we are talking with the customers that they are not oriented on this, of course, one way is to create it like a small teams and separated, then isolated, then and they get into the speeds. But with the working backwards, this type of work, we can bring them inside of the organizations and create an environment where they can success. One thing that we learned is that it requires two type of leaders and very senior leaders sponsoring these opportunities. One coming from technology side, doesn't matter if it's a CIO, CTO, CDO, but it needs to be someone connected with the technology side of the business. And one that is responsible for the business, line of business managers, C-levels, top executives. But these two sponsorships, they are forms like an alliance that allows the team to look for what is right for the customer. And that will require you to create a core, your own environment that sustained this transformation, and that will be able like to create a new type of deliverables, like in a speed, same as you have it in a startup, but it not so disconnected with from your core as a startup or an external team is. And one additional things that we asked for the our customers when we started this journey together is that there is no right or wrong. This is a learning experience. And we try our best. We have an intentionality to be the most successful as possible. But if we don't be successful, that is a learning experience. We don't look at it for failure, but we look at it to create experiments. We don't like it empty failure that is no one is looking for or understanding what you are doing. We look at it for to learn along the journey. And even in opportunities that we didn't succeed, we didn't reach the goals that we had in the past, we could learn. And the next opportunity will pay back for every learning opportunities that we have before that. And from learning to learning, we've been closer in a point to the customers that no one else in our industry has been. So we learn it also doing this with our customers, that even the opportunities that we tried it, but we didn't reach the point, is closer to pivot to a new idea and is closer to understand the customers. And it means that you've been obsessed by your customer. So we don't require it to be external all the time to have it at this speed, but it requires sponsorship and requires the vision for the company that this experiment don't need to be right, but need to have the permission to learn.
How do you kind of strategize and make it more tactical in terms of like, it's a completely different way of work. Like I imagine like it's very, very different from, you know, following a 60-page business case where it's oriented, you know, towards, you know, the only shareholders of your clients. So you're trying to teach them to go after, you know, metrics and KPIs and their customer, your client's customer, right? So how do you actually materialize it in terms of, you know, what success looks like in terms of, you know, KPIs or goals? Like how often you look at those to actually to come to a point and say, this is actually, you know, we didn't succeed or we did succeed, and how we measure success and how we actually transfer that responsibility and ownership to the entrepreneurs that are after those goals, right? So is there any kind of trick there or any insights that you could share that you think that were that are useful for you know, people that are after that?
One thing to share is that as a We have opportunities in both directions, like the traditionals that we call low-hanging fruits, as all the companies has. And there is also process, mechanisms, things that we think that is untouchable in the company because it's so tied to the core, or they are so big, or they are legacy for so many time that everybody is afraid to change that. One thing that we try to evaluate it in when we talk with our customers and including internally is how deep we need to go to challenge it ourselves. One thing that Amazon looked for is to create their own competitor. So if you needed to have a competitor in the world, it's better to be us than better to than expected someone else to create something that will delight our own customers. So we don't think that our customers is with us forever. We don't take it as granted. We don't think that they trust in us forever. So we needed to regain their and rebuild their trust every time that we interact with them. And the opportunities that we identified it coming from top down or to bottom up, and we look it for to evaluate it then in the same way as I'm telling you, that is, if it's something that we needed to develop it because it will challenge it us or because it will challenge it our own technology or on legacy systems. If the answer is yes, probably it's very important for us to create an initiative to address this. It can be either way. It can be someone internally in the field, in the edge that it knows the customers that propose this, or someone in the leadership. It's important that we capture this idea. And that will be part of also the internal evaluation of the ideas. So independently how they ignite the idea, we look at for these signs internally that if it's something that we'd like to explore or not. So when we started for this, our conversations with the customers and our own mentality is, if it's something that prevents us to move forward, probably we should look at for these opportunities. If you're talking with a bank that says that the mainframe is not possible to move, everyone else that is tied with the mainframe will say that your systems cannot be moved. If you're talking with logistic companies that their data warehouse is tied with a heavy lifted database and they cannot move it, this database, they will say the same thing. So when Amazon in his own history, when they decided to experiment with this mentality, we decided to tackle the most complex and important systems that we had in our warehouse. So we decided that all our database, we needed to be exported to create an environment where the people could explore these ideas. And because of the all the teams were saying that this database was so complex that we cannot move it, we had executive decisions that should be the first systems to move. What happens in a fast forward is that when we be able to move it, all of this was a very long journey. No one else could sustain that this is his own systems cannot be moved. So like, hey, look at it. The most complex systems for all the teams was moved. So why you cannot move it? There is no reason. So and at this point is where we check and balance it with our customers, because like a low hanging fruits is some things that can give you a few abilities in a short term. But in a long run, if you don't look at for these opportunities that are preventing you to transform your organizations and created a strategic initiatives to address this, you never will be able to transition, never will be able to become in a learning company. And that's what we talk to the customer. So like and the metrics of the success and how we defined the success and all of these, we adapted case by case, and we looked for the team to figure out how are their success in these opportunities. So each opportunity has their own definition of success. And that's also the beauty of the Amazon, because it's no one size fits all rule. And each teams are the best ones to decide upfront how the success looks like. The combination of these that we look at when we talk to the customer, because like only the low-hanging fruits and predefined success metrics will not be able to address this complex and largest situation. So to give it one tip is you have already a lot of experience in working with low-hanging fruits. Try to do something different with the most complex, long-term thinking, complex systems, legacies that you have in your company.
Try to be a low-hanging fruit combiner, like meat busters. Challenge the deep beliefs of the company. That's I love that that one two combination there. So a more detail. If you can give a little more detail, like for example, you said like the teams define the success criteria by themselves. So how often senior leadership will check or what type of autonomy they have, like or is any rule of thumb like they can have a runaway of how many years, like the funding for those initiatives, how long they can be, or is like it's more gradual, like they get an amount of funding to do a thing for 6 months and then they have kind of to reassess again, like how that process of funding those initiatives work at Amazon?
Yeah, the funding process is started with the writing of a press release. So we use internally our own system. So if you see the working backwards that people say is in the field regarding it is all true. So we have to write it, you have to create a narrative about your idea. And as you started your narrative, the first question is, can you start it right now? Like, do you need any funding? Do you need anything? Or can you just be like at a part-time, an extra effort that you are able to explore this idea? As long as this idea started to grow and you needed more investments and you needed to present it to someone else, then it started to look at for your narratives, look at for your documents, and the team internally, the management helped you to escalate this. So, for example, if I'm writing a narrative that required someone from other teams that be involved, the management of my line will read this narrative and supported me or and give me tips and give me feedbacks about my document in order to scale internally in the organizations for other teams to get an investment. If I receive an investment, that comes also with a second line is how much it is, for how long I will evaluate your business. So all of these items that you asked me, they are predefined. They are part of the rules of the game, but they are there is no one size fits all. Like we know for experience from these many years that depending on what you are asking, you needed this type of funding or that type of funding. Sometimes it's just a matter like that you give you a license from your day job to explore an idea for a few years. Sometimes you needed more investments. Sometimes you needed investments upfront. Like you needed to create these teams upfront and invest in these teams and seed these as the same as an internal startup. But there is no one size fits all again. So
the process is known and actually there's a practice to do this. And so one of the lessons I think I take away from that, from Amazon, and I actually try to kind of convince our clients to go with, like, we see a lot of clients trying to be innovative try to put together a change management approach, which is only geared towards communication and trying to change people's mindset as was an option, senior leadership asking people to be customer centric, like, hey, you have just to be customer centric. I love the Amazon approach because it's not about being customer centric as was our option or an attitude issue. It's like you have to practice customer centricity. Like, the process to submit a new idea is actually a process where you're going to practice putting ourselves in the shoes of the client, shoes of your customers. And the whole process makes you, you know, practice customer centricity, the whole, and the same thing you're talking about innovation and funding. The process, you know, it kind of makes you practice those skills and behaviors and flex that muscle that makes you, you know, achieve those new behaviors and new mindset, right? So it's not, you're always becoming, right? That thing is that you're not send people to a nice, you know, training session, inspiring training session, and hope, you know, that they will come back on Monday morning and be customer centric or be innovative. If you don't actually in your day by day, in their job, it's not designed, embedded in the job, in that process.
And it's as you mentioned, it's like a muscle. Like you start to exercise it, and it come bigger and it come stronger. When you join the company and you see in a meeting someone asking, "Hey, what is the customer in this story? Why are you doing this for the customer? How is for the customer?" So you see that is true. It's legitimate that the people is pursuing the customer perspective in every moment, in all the decisions, in front all the levels and all the roles. So that becomes also your own obsession. Like you started to exercise it, a behavior that you have it inside of you, and you have it that permits you to, allows you to do this. One thing that you mentioned is that very important for us, that we believe that these behaviors align, it is very powerful, but it's not enough. We look at it for to create mechanisms that are processed, that don't say the people what they need to do, but they empowered the people to exercise it, to create it, to pursue their passions. So these mechanisms, they are ways that we figure out how to address recurrent problems, recurrent issues that we had in the past, how to tackle these opportunities in a more organized way. And we always say that they are in this moment, we can do and we can move and we can change them all the times. So there is no mechanisms that is in a way that you cannot change it. But if you have any suggestions and you executed these mechanisms a few times, you are also able to suggest the changes. So we see that the mechanism is also created their own life. And with these combinations of the culture, this obsession for the customers, and the mechanisms that give you the way that you put your ideas and practice, they help the people to become like put it there in action. So they are ideas in actions. So when we talk of the customers, is the customers that have this heavy process and or very well organized across the world, the process that is, we ask it then to be more soft, like you have it to align it the execution, you have it to align it your expectations when the people use the process, but you cannot have it like a one process for all the change management, that for all the communications that works across all the organizations. So with this, and given the ability for the people to use their mechanisms in the right places at the right time and to suggestions improvements on this, we also becoming an organization that is listening to people. And with this back and forth, we be able like to capture ideas from the market, capture ideas from the customers, and exercise it in terms of our culture. But because it's not just one pillar. It's like we are seeing customers that are saying a lot about culture, but they are not talking about their mechanisms, their process, their architecture, their organizations. So we learned from this journey that these four pillars work together. There is the culture, the process, the architecture, and the organizations. And we had to evolve all of them in the same pace. We have to look at for all of them, and we have to challenge it all of them at the same time. So that is one thing that we learned internally, that we applied in our customers. And when you apply it in a very small, in a thin slice of this cake inside of the customers, you see that they have a very strong power to cross-pollinate this type of mindset, this type of execution, because the other teams look for that and see, hey, I wanted this type of execution. I wanted this type of freedom. I wanted this type of challenges. I wanted to give you the ideas that I'm working with to escalate in the company. And that's where this wheel will start to spin. So.
As we talk internally at CI&T, like nothing speeds up change more than success. People are successful working a different way, and they want more of that. And that's kind of and usually we say like, I don't know, the organization moves by corporate jealousy, mm-hmm. like people, I want that. They go, yeah. I want that. If you try to push change on them, it's, oh, I'm good. I'm a rock star. I'm doing well. Usually we're talking, I'm pretty sure your clients, like our clients, are very successful organizations. So you go there, we have to change completely the way we work. Like, why? I'm killing here, man. Like, I don't want to change anything. But when they see someone in their organization being more successful than them, oh, I want that.
All right, exactly. Right,
so that's a much, much smarter way to actually introduce corporate change and way smoother than kind of try to push everybody at the same time, like that big bang type of transformation. I love that you guys think the same way and having the same experience. Ricardo, really, thank you so much. I learned so much here. Like I love a couple of those tips on how to introduce that such a complex topic, how to introduce a culture and process that actually will empower people. Love the how how much of that is actually empowering people to do the changes that they see and empower them to solve a very practicalized innovation about solving customers' needs, you know, and try to anticipate them. Love the practicality and the approach. Thank you so much for your kindness to join here and share your wisdom with us. And with that, looking forward to the next episode, guys. Thank you so much. Thank you, Ricardo.
Thank you. Bye so much.